At some point in our yoga journey, we come across the word prana and pranayama. And this leads to a lot of confusion. So I wanted to do a video which clears up the confusion about prana and pranayama so you know what these things are. Hi, my name is Ashwin. I'm the Himalayan Yogi. Prana in Sanskrit means life. And we know that something is alive only when it interacts with us in a way that we would respond. That's when we know that it's alive. So if something responds either with pain or pleasure, we know that it's alive. And if we're able to receive its pain or pleasure as a communication, then we know that it's alive. So these channels of communication which we have with everything and the data which comes back saying that something is alive, that is what is called prana. Now we understand that this is not done through any means that is wired. It's not done through any means that even requires you to have any kind of physical contact. It's a wireless communication, right? When we look at a stone, we feel that the stone doesn't have prana, but it's possible for us to communicate with it and understand things from its perspective. It's not anthropomorphization, but it's understanding things from the stone's perspective. It's not projecting a human consciousness upon the stone, but really trying to perceive what the stone's consciousness is trying to tell us. And there are channels of communication open with us between all the elements. If you go to nature, it's not just the trees, you can even communicate with the water and the elements which we consider lifeless, but they all have prana. So prana is there everywhere, and prana is the channels of communication that we have between ourselves and everything else. As a result of this communication, which is a two-way communication, we either get nourished or we get depleted. And that is what we need to understand. The pranayama is a way to completely always get nourished constantly and continuously from all of the prana that is floating around, all of the channels of communication that are floating around. So when you hear the word prana, replace it by channels of communication, which can either nourish you or can deplete you in ways that we see as a life force. Okay, so that's how prana got this label as life force. If I come and appreciate you, if I come and genuinely express gratitude to you, or if I come and express genuine care to you, then you get nourished, and that is prana. If I come and tear you down, if I say bad things to you, if I behave poorly and in an aggressive or a hostile way with you, then I am tearing you down, which is means I am depleting prana in you. Okay? So it depends on the type of communication. If the communication is positive, then there's a buildup of prana. And if the communication is negative, there's a depletion of prana. Now think of the various ways in which we can communicate. We can communicate not only from our five senses, we can communicate stories, ideas, we can communicate desires, we can communicate in so many ways. In fact, there are a total of 16 ways in which we can communicate non-verbally according to yoga. And I'll not go into those 16 ways in this video, but I'll go into it in one of the future videos. So, mastering these 16 ways of communication is pranayama. Now, our breath is something that is constantly communicating with everything around us. And we are inhaling not just air, but we're inhaling information. And this is one of the primary ways in which we are in constant communication with the rest of the world. We are letting the world know about us, and we are taking in information about the world. So every person's breath's information is in the world everywhere. And if you learn how to tune into these things, that's called pranayama. If you want to hold your breath, that's called kumbhaka. Kumbhaka is holding your breath either inside or outside. When you empty your lungs, then obviously the breath is outside, but you're holding your breath and you're not allowing it to progress further. So there's Bahir Kumbhaka, which is holding your breath out, and Antar Kumbhaka, which is holding your breath in. Bahir Kumbhaka is also known as Shunyaka. So there are only four phases of your breath. There's inhalation, there's exhalation, there's holding your breath in, and there's holding your breath out. That's all you can do. The kumbhakas allow us to discontinue the flow of information and therefore work upon arranging the information which is within ourselves. And that's how kumbhaka got so much prominence in hatha yoga, because yogis discovered that by holding their breath, they can organize the information within themselves. And if somebody has given you information which depletes you, you can rearrange it and reframe it in such a way that it doesn't deplete you anymore. So pranayama is very powerful. There's molecular communication, which is neurochemicals, and then there is cellular communication, which happens wirelessly as well. So it's not always a molecule, okay? So there's molecular communication and non-molecular energy communication, which modulates electromagnetic energy around us, and it can communicate. Both of these are considered prana. The information traveling, the channel itself, is considered prana. In fact, there are 10 channels of prana, 10 different channels recognized in yoga. Again, I cannot go into it in this video, but I'll go into it in one of the future videos. And we have control over all of these. Prana actually specifically refers to a form of communication coming from the heart. So the heart has the highest electrical energy and it does a lot of communication. So when you go and sit with someone, what you feel as vibrations from them or vibes is actually the information coming from their heart. So you have good-hearted people and you have evil-hearted people. And if you sit with them, you can feel the difference and you might resonate. Everybody is partially evil, everybody is partially good. So you might resonate depending on your own mood and your own internal environment, which is part of your heart's energy, which is prana. It also flows into your hands. So it's things you do with your hands that can give prana. That's why massage is very effective to heal people. Reiki is done through the hands, where you can heal people with prana. Prana and chi and everything, they are similar concepts. Remember, we cannot be alive without prana. As soon as prana is gone, we are dead. So if prana, the channels get damaged, we're not able to receive information for some reason, if the cells cannot communicate, then the person dies, the person checks out of the building. But what about the data itself? Can the data be preserved? Yes. The data can be preserved in the prana that's all around us. So the data of what you call your mind can get transferred. It can move out of your body and it can move into other bodies and whatever. So that's called transfer of prana, transfer of data about yourself. So that brings us to the end of this video. Thank you very much for watching. Hope you enjoyed this. And if you want others to enjoy it, hit share. Thank you very much.